I'm gonna ask you to show up here. We'll get used to the sound thing here, and I'll just keep talking. Hopefully, all these strange noises. But I think it was a few years ago, I came down with kind of a COVID-like symptom, and I didn't show up, and it was on the screen. And about 3 or 4 days ago, I started to get this cold, and I thought, I am not gonna let her know. But I just wanted to send her a little note to say, hey, fight Nicole, just make sure you have another ultimate message planned. But here we are, a little bit of a raspy voice, a bottle of water, and we're good to go. And I'm feeling great. So it's really good to be here this morning. I must say that when I was scraping my car off this morning, I was thinking of Brent down in Cuba that he has to suffer so. It's just amazing how the Lord calls us to these warm climates in the cold. Not funny, a little bit funny there, but I do bless Linda and Bruce and Sharon and their family as well. We pray for them as a district here down here in Cuba. What a privilege. What a privilege to be there. To bless them this morning. So Psalm 63, verses 1 to 8. The psalm, when I was reading it, I was just following along in a kind of a style of teaching that I'm going through right now, and just learning how to be meditative in the psalm. And so I was reading this psalm, and I didn't know too much about it, to be honest. And then I found out it actually was decreed in the early church that a day should not pass without this psalm being publicly sung. I had no idea. And so today, my heart is that as we listen to God's word, that we learn how to just be in it, not hurrying, not rushing. I don't know about you, but my devotional time used to be, I'd read it, kind of check it off, I'd go through my little prayer list, and I'd read a devotional. My wife and I had a Christian bookstore, and I jokingly say that if I'm accountable for some of the things we sold, I'm sorry now in advance. But we had a book, and it was called The 1 Minute Devotions with God. I thought, 1 minute with God? Oh my goodness, how can I do that? But I guess 1 minute's better than no minutes, but you get what I mean. And here's this song, and I want to go through it with that understanding that just David's whole focus was God. It wasn't just a short little time in the morning. His whole focus was God. And I love verse 1 where he starts off and says, oh God, God. And in that statement of God, what he's really declaring is, there is no other God anywhere else that is like you. He's announcing Elohim, Yahweh. You are the true God. All other gods are false gods. Nothing can compare to you. Let's see. Not the God of the pagans, not the God anybody else worships, not the moon or the stars or anything. He clearly states, God, you are my God, and there's no compromise in anything else. And I love how it moves into that you are my God. It's easy to say our Father. A little harder to say my God. But it keeps with us. It's easy to say our God. What about my God? And he clearly states, you are my God. And in his position, he's not only recognized as a king, he's got great power, even though he's in this desert place, and life isn't the best of circumstances. He's got all of this, and yet he recognizes, and I love this about him, he's a political figure, he's a king. And yet he recognizes there is someone higher than me. God, the true God, you are greater than me. One with whom I bow my knees and recognize that you are God. What an outcome that nation would appreciate with a leader like that. Greater than any other idol in his life. When I say that word, I think, are you not familiar that we could even have idols in our lives today? What does it mean to have an idol? What does it mean to have something that would replace God? What are you talking about? A little fat statue sitting on the ground somewhere? An idol is anything that takes you away from God, distracts you from Him. Where you put your focus, where you put your energy, where you put your hope in. When I there's one true God. Our God, my God. It's in you I put my hope and my trust. All the rest of this can so easily become distractions. An idol can be a time, a bonus, a budget. I'm honestly amused, and they don't say this too critically, anybody, but I'm amused when people say they don't have really time to be with God. Really. You're just missing out on the pure joy of what life is all about. And I pray that you capture some of that this morning with this song. Because the thought behind it is, my God, oh my God. And he goes on to say, I earnestly search for you. I earnestly seek you. And earnestly, my father's name was Ernest, and I didn't quite know what it meant. And I love to look up English words and find out what earth they really mean. Different spelling here, but earnest means intense. I intensely seek you. Well, let this be first and foremost about me. I'm not coming up here to tell you that I am David and that I do this, but what this song has been doing for me, and that is literally sitting in this song for about 2 weeks now. Learn what it is, Lord, what does it mean to me to intensely seek you? I'm in the world, I work, I drive, I go down to Queensway, I go into Ottawa, there's all these distractions. We have grandkids, we have a home, we're planning on moving, blah, 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 all this stuff. But in spite of all of that, how do I live my life earnestly seeking you? That was what David lived. And I believe the words of the prophet Jeremiah come to play here when he said to Israel, he said, if you seek me with all your heart, I will be found in you, declares the Lord. Or it's not a futile search. It's not sort of like a hoping to find God. You will find God. He rewards those who earnestly seek him, says the Hebrew. And James says he will draw near to you. He rewards the seeking of him, not for what we gain, but rather his presence. David wasn't after God to do things for him as much as he was to be in the presence of God. He goes on in verse 1 and says, my soul thirsts for you. My whole being longs for you in this parched land where there is no water. Physically, David's body would be very familiar with what it's like to have no water. He's writing this from a desert place. I don't know if you've been in a desert place. It's really fascinating. My wife and I have been there a couple times in Mexico with a group of people with a mission. And it's so hot that your skin just gets crusted with salt because your sweat evaporates. You don't sweat anywhere. You feel crusty and you lick your lips, they're salty. You're thirsty. You're insatiably drinking water and you can't drink enough of it. My soul thirsts for you. Pretty dramatic the way he writes it, but my whole being longs for you. When I was thinking about this, I thought, my whole being longs for you. Yes, it does. And in the New Testament teachings, we're taught about what is it to give a surrendered life to God. My being is meant to be consumed. My thoughts, my body, soul, and spirit consumed by you. And David touches on this in this beautiful song. I thirst for you. My wife and I were closing down our business. It was a dark, dark night, but we just thought, what have we done wrong? How could we have come to this place? The whole world contentious place of realizing where I am and who I'm at, and man, it just stops me from this busyness to get down to what is really going on. In that situation with my wife and I, it turned out that, I would say that was 9 years ago, right about now, we actually closed our store, the sale, we closed it, and those past 9 years, leaving something that was so precious to me, has led us into something that exceeds anything I could consider precious. But it's hard. Discomfort reveals what it is otherwise to us. So what motivated David in the midst of this discomfort? I don't know about you, but when I'm in discomfort, my first go-to is not, "Oh God, you are my God, I earnestly praise and bless you." I usually utter a little bit of like, "What is going on? Why are you doing this? This is hard. I don't like it. Oh, David, he's in the desert. Everything's going wrong. And here he is. Oh, God, you are my God. What on earth motivated him?" And we find that in verse 2 when he says, "I've seen you in your sanctuary and gazed upon the power of the Lord." When we taste the trueness of God, we find there's nothing else to satisfy. There's nothing else to be desired. The true belonging to him. And David saw that. I was looking at this thinking, so where did he see God in the sanctuary? And the commentator says what this meant was, the reference here is to what was manifested of the presence and power of God in the services of public worship, the praises, the prayers, the rejoicing, the evidence of the divine presence. So the psalmist calls to mind former experiences in this sanctuary, and these stimulate him to an eager desire.